on this Sunday morning, proclaiming the good news that the sting of death is no more. Jesus Christ is alive. The grave and the stone which sealed the tomb could not hold him anymore. The grief of Good Friday has been replaced with the joyous shouts of Easter Alleluias. So happy Easter, and I am glad that you are here with us. John's Gospel, the author seems to highlight these one-on-one encounters with Jesus. Think of Nicodemus coming to Jesus at night, the woman at the well, Martha and her sister Mary. And the resurrection story is no different in John's Gospel. We're allowed to experience what Mary and Peter and the disciple that Jesus loved, we think is John, what they presumably experienced when they went to the tomb of Jesus. In John's account, Mary Magdalene makes her way to the tomb when it's still dark. The darkness of the early morning hour for which Mary finds herself parallels yet pales to the darkness that Mary and the other disciples have experienced over these last 3 days. On the cusp of the Sabbath, when no work was allowed, Jesus' body was taken down from the cross and laid in the tomb, but his body had yet not been completely prepared for burial. The completion of the burial preparation would have to wait until after the Sabbath was over. So Mary was returning to the grave to do just that. On the walk to the tomb, I imagine she was preparing herself for the task for which she had to do, for what her sight would see, what her sight of smell would smell, what she would have to endure. Walking in the darkness of early morning, walking in the darkness of her thoughts, walking in the darkness of loss and hurt and pain. Can you imagine the horror that must have coursed through her when she saw that the large stone that was rolled in front of Jesus' tomb was moved? That is a sure sign of grave robbers in that time. The scripture reads, "So she ran and went to Simon Peter and the other disciples, the one whom Jesus loved, and said to them, 'They have taken the Lord out of the tomb, and we do not know where they have laid him.'" Their Lord and teacher, cruelly beaten, shamed, hung on a cross to die in the most painful and agonizing way to die. And if that's not enough, now they have to endure the sign that grave robbers are present. Could the darkness get any darker? Could the darkness get any darker? Have you in your lifetime ever asked that question? Could the darkness get any darker? I know I have, and I suspect you have as well. Mary and the disciples are steeped in this question. Peter and the disciples, referred to as the one Jesus loved, take off at a dead run towards the tomb, hoping that what they heard from Mary is not true. He said the two were running together, but the other disciple outran Peter and reached the tomb first. He bent down to look in and saw the linen wrappings lying there, but he did not go in. Then Simon Peter, following him, went into the tomb. He saw the linen wrappings lying there, the cloth that had been on Jesus' head, not lying with the linen wrappings, but rolled up in a place by itself. Then the other disciple who reached the tomb first also went in, and he saw and believed. For as yet they did not understand the scripture that he must rise from the dead. Then the disciples returned to their homes. The disciple whom Jesus loved finally enters the tomb, and scripture John? Is that what he believed? Did he believe that a divine something had occurred? Because the clothes of death had been shed and remained in the tomb, purposely folded and rolled and laid in a manner that would not have occurred if grave robbers were the cause of Jesus missing. And this is far different than what they had experienced just prior to this when Lazarus died and Jesus raised him from the dead. When Jesus called Lazarus out from the tomb, Lazarus was still wrapped in his grave clothes, the clothes of death. He was still bound by his grave clothes. And it was not until Jesus said and commanded the crowd, "Unbind him and let him go," that he was free from the wrappings of death. In Jesus' tomb, the wrappings of death are left behind. Whatever he believed that day when he looked into the tomb, he was not yet fully understanding what was going on. And so he and Peter left the tomb. Mary, on the other hand, stayed. Mary's my kind of gal. She's not leaving the tomb. She is not going to leave until she gets Jesus back. All the other disciples now are in their homes, locked away. But she says, "No, I'm staying." And she never tries to seek an answer of why or how this happened, or who even did it. But she wants to know where Jesus is, where his body is. So Mary musters enough courage now to look into the tomb. And unlike the other two disciples, Mary sees the presence of two angels, one sitting at his feet and one sitting where his head should have been. And the angels ask her, "Why are you weeping?" All I can say to that is, well, duh! Right? She's looking for her Lord and Savior, and as she's telling them that her Lord has been taken, and she turns and sees who she thinks is the gardener, and he too asks, "Why are you weeping? Who are you looking for?" She desperately appeals again for knowledge of where Jesus is. Mary gets her answer, but certainly not in the way she was expecting. The answer comes in the hearing of her name. In the hearing of her name, Mary is transformed. Her perspective is transformed. And the words of Isaiah 43 are fulfilled. Isaiah 43 says, "Do not fear, for I have redeemed you. I have called you by name, and you are mine. When you pass through the waters, I will be with you, and through the rivers, you shall not overwhelm you. When you walk through the fire, you shall not be burned, and the flame shall not consume you. For I am the Lord your God, the Holy One of Israel, your Savior." Mary started her day wondering if the darkness could get any darker. But the light of Jesus broke through, and he called her by name, and she was transformed. Mary was changed by the hearing of her name. She went from confusion and despair to a confident proclaimer and disciple of Christ. She went back to the rest of the disciples and now did not proclaim a message of despair like she did earlier, but she said with great boldness, "I have seen the Lord." She was now interpreting her world through the eyes of the resurrection rather than previously through the eyes of her earthly perspective. The resurrection not some past event that we celebrate once a year. Resurrection is how we make sense of our lives here and now. When Jesus says in John chapter 16, "So you will have grief now, but I will see you again, and your hearts will rejoice, and no one will take your joy from you." That's not some fanciful hope that might come true someday. It's a truth that is available to us right now, right here, for each one of us. And he goes on to say in that chapter, "I have said this to you so that in me you may have peace. Because in this world you will have trouble, but take courage. I have overcome the world." We're called as the church to not forget the light, but proclaim the light of the risen Christ, not as a past event, but as a daily present reality. We rejoice and shout praises of Alleluia at the question, "Can the darkness get any darker?" We answer that question with, "It is soundly defeated by the light of Christ, by the eternal light of Christ." We're called to help others interpret the world through the lens of resurrection, because people need to hear, "I've seen the Lord." Because, frankly, all of us, when you turn on the TV, what do we see? What do we hear on social media? We hear violence and pain and hatred and corruption and lies and racism, and the story goes on and on, doesn't it? We have to be empowered to say for ourselves, "I've seen the Lord in the midst of all of that." It seems to be opposite of what we hear and see. The resurrection and the ascension of Jesus is the cornerstone of our faith. It is what gives us purpose and direction when we are perplexed. It gives us confidence when the storms of life threaten to overpower us. It gives us hope when all seems to be lost. Those two verses in John 16, "For you have grief now, but I will see you again, and your hearts will rejoice, and no one will take your joy from you. I have said this to you so that in me you may have peace. In this world you will have trouble, but take courage," Jesus says. "I've overcome the world." It's the true hope of resurrection for us on this very day. I remember a couple of years ago when my son was 15, we were driving in the car, and it's one of those moments when you get to drive with your kids, kind of the best times to have conversations with our kids. And he says, "You know, I think Grandma Ruth has a joy I've never seen in anyone else." And he was talking about my mom. And our son was going through some hard times at the time. And for him to see this joy in my mom and recognize it as something different than he's ever seen in anyone before. My mom has a joy that just kind of exudes out of her pores. It's not because she's had this amazing life. It's because she has this faith in Christ, in the risen light of Christ, that she has the joy of Christ in her, despite losing two husbands, despite having two kids that have gone off somewhere else. She's had more pain and grief in her life than anyone should ever have to face, yet she has the light of Christ in her heart, to the point that a 15-year-old who is slugging through the darkness can see it. That's something amazing to me. And that's what we celebrate. Resurrection isn't a past event, it's right now. And we can have that. The love of Christ in our heart. We need disciples like Mary to name what what the world sees, and then name how resurrection enables us to see the world differently. Because what you and I see is not what has to be. You don't have to wait to get to heaven to experience the life with joy and peace. That's available to us each and every day when we interpret our world through the love and promises of Jesus Christ and his resurrection. He defeated the death that we get from sin. When we interpret our world not through our circumstances, but through the love of Christ, our earthly eyes will interpret a world that is transforming. It's a transforming perspective of life. And that is